Hello everyone, my name is Harshada, and today I will be sharing some of our recent updates in Visual Studio's debugging and diagnostic space. So let's get started into the demo. So here I have an open source application called ShareX. It runs on your local and lets you take screenshots on your screen or perform different tasks. So when I was working around this application, I noticed an inconsistent bug sometimes when I was trying to launch that it's not able to find a local path. I started my investigation, ended up on this method called update was loopback. From the name and the code looks like somewhere here we are setting a path. So I placed my breakpoint here on line 462. As I mentioned, the error was inconsistent, so I didn't want this breakpoint to hit every time when I run my application. So I thought, why not convert this to a conditional breakpoint? So I'm gonna go to settings and select conditions. Now, as you know, conditional breakpoints are really great if you want to be in control of execution of your breakpoint. You can decide when and when not the breakpoint can hit. But sometimes coming up with those conditions, even remembering syntax or understanding different options is not always straightforward. And that's why I'm going to ask Copilot for help here. As soon as I place my cursor, you can see Copilot works in the background and provides me with these three expression suggestions, which might work for my code here. As I'm very familiar with this code, I'm going to go with the first one. You can even create your own condition if you don't want to use the Copilot suggested one. These expression suggestions also works great with actions or trace point. Copilot actually can suggest some of the status messages for your application. I'm going to close here, and you can see now my breakpoint is a conditional breakpoint here. As we're talking about breakpoints here, do you guys ever had a scenario when you are actually debugging a complex application, or you're debugging multiple issues at the same time, and then you end up having this huge list of breakpoints? That list is definitely not very easy to navigate or even manage. So I used to have that too, but recently I started using breakpoint groups. So as you can see here in my breakpoints window, I already create many groups here. So creating a group is super easy. You can do that using this new drop-down box and select breakpoint group. And moving a breakpoint to a group is more easier. You just need to select, drag and drop to the breakpoint group you need. Now, if I need to focus on a particular area of debugging, for example, for this demo, I'm not really interested in any of these non-demo breakpoints to hit. I can actually disable this whole set of breakpoints in a single click, and I can focus on area where I need to. In our recent preview release, that is 17.11.p2, we added another improvement here that is called Deform Breakpoint Group. So you can select any of the existing group and mark the breakpoint group as default, like this. What it does is, after this, any of the breakpoints which are created will get automatically added here. For example, I'm going to place a random breakpoint here on line 459, and you can see that gets added here. This makes it more easier to work around breakpoints and also around breakpoint groups. So now, as we have looked into breakpoints, let's continue further and see what else we have. So another thing I wanted to show you here is this particular method. Looks like we are setting up some of the tasks which we can perform on under this application. I was more interested to see different values which are coming in these variables. So instead of hovering over each of them, what I can do is I can actually hover over this object and use enumerable visualizer. As you can see, I can see all the data in just single view. If you don't know, Visual Studio actually supports many different types of debug visualizers, such as HTML, JSON, XML, dataset, and an enumerable visualizer. And we recently made all of our managed visualizers as non-modal. What it means is that you can keep it hanging like this, or you can actually go to this drop-down menu, dock it as a window, or dock it as a top document. And the best part is you can still interact with the editor in the background. So I'm going to comment out this particular item here, continue my debugging, and you can see the real-time change here. You can actually also use multiple types of visualizers at the same time. So you can have like a text visualizer and an enumerable visualizer open at the same time, maybe with the different screens, and it should still work fine. Again, in our recent preview release, that is 17.11.p2, we added another handy feature, and that is this expressions text box here. So this expression text box lets you write your own link queries to filter on data. Now, I have a very small data here, but imagine the data with hundreds and thousands of rows. Having your own link query will make it super easy to filter out on the way you want to. So I'm going to write a very simple link query here or link expression here to filter out my data. And as soon as I hit enter, you can see it automatically filters out the data in however I want it. So that's what I have for today. There are many other Copilot assisted features which we released recently in our 1710 GA. So if you haven't already, please check out our GA blog and learn more about exception assistance, deadlock detection, and profiler auto insights. Thank you. Thank you for joining.